name is Jason Scott. I run a place called textfiles.com, which is a website dedicated to, well, its official mantra is we are the official place for bulletin board system texts of the 1980s. Now, to make that work, if you used one of these, this was that era. Basically, what happened was, by its very nature, bulletin board systems had a lot of text files on them where people traded, and the nature of the distribution channel was that you had single-line phones, and so basically it was very slow as compared to today. So as a result, there were a lot of files that people kept, but when the internet came along, the real push was for things that were aimed already up on FTP sites and internet. So we have a real huge amount of text files that were created after, say, 1993, 1994, and not as many that were created from the 80s or even the 70s or the 60s. So I was really concerned about that stuff going away, and so I started taking my text file collection, and I started taking text file collections of others and putting it together. When I spoke last year, I had 9,000 text files with a bunch in the inbox. Now I'm at 23,000 text files. I'm not stopping, and luckily most of the important ones, the ones that people usually think of, are up on there. Now, what I'm talking about today is less about what the history was at that time and more about what it's like to run textfiles.com, because I'm a solid sitting duck target for some very interesting groups of people. And, you know, I figured that'd be somewhat amusing. What I'm doing is I'm actually technically a file archive. I like to think of myself as a librarian. I'm really not writing my own stuff except for to comment on stuff that's already written, or I am putting together things by my own weird little classification system so people can download it quicker. One thing I do find is that people have some very distinct ideas about what they want, so I started putting archives of the sections together, and I can see very quickly what people like. The number one search on my engine is how to make LSD. Every month, 30 to 40 hits, how to make LSD. Now, one of the other things that's very interesting about my site is because I have 23,000 text files currently numbering around 500 or 600 megabytes of text, you get some pretty wacky search matches. So my referral log can really clear your sinuses. Now, I would have preferred just being some quiet little thing off in the corner, you know, doing my little work, bringing it up, making sure people knew about it and sending it out there, but life isn't like that on the internet anymore. The thing that, well, basically, in an ideal world, okay, a lot of people come up on panels and speeches like this and they spend a long time going, I think freedom is very good and I'd like you all to agree with me. And they spend a lot of time telling you basically that freedom is good. Well, yeah, I believe freedom is very good too. But what I'm worried about are the people who don't recognize that they're against some things which freedom would actually, you know, cover, because they have their own agenda. One of the little themes that has always gone through bulletin board systems, and it's effective now, are the twin towers of bombs and drugs. As long as bulletin board systems have been in existence, and certainly today, boys, adolescents and older, like to blow shit up and like to smoke shit up.
I like to call that the Beavis and Butthead syndrome.
Yes, exactly. I do understand that. I do have some dark portions of my past. When I was 13 years old, I was busted in my school for selling ASCII pornography. I'm sure you all have similar skeletons in your closet. The basically, we were printing out a file on my system called Angela.art, and we're just printing it and selling it for 50 cents a pop to the highest bidder, whoever wanted it. This was quickly discovered by our crack security force at my school, and I was hauled into the principal's office, and that's where I first really came up against an authority figure, where I really didn't think I was wrong. on an issue of expression. Basically, he was like, do you know how wrong it is of what you're doing? And I said, no. And he said, you know, don't you think this is wrong? And I said, being an ass, I see a bunch of letters and numbers, sir. I don't know what you see. I lost it, but I used to have, when I got detention, I had a little slip that said, you know, selling of erotic art images in school or something, or whatever the dumb little trumped up charge was. There was actually another one, I sure learned, 2 years later, I'm in my class, and there's a call, hello, you know, Jason, please come to the main office. And so I come to the main office, there's my mom, there's the principal, there's a man in a suit, this isn't good. Man in the suit comes out from the, it says, I'm from the FBI. This is definitely not good. We found out you were selling nitroglycerin plans to kids. 50 cents a pop. Turns out one of the kids had, dad was a cop, dad wasn't pleased. Dad found it in his kid's notebook called the FBI. FBI said, where'd you get this? I said, some board in Illinois, I don't know. And they said, okay, don't do that again. Which was surprising. When I was 14, I figured I could really kick my ass, but they didn't. And why was I doing that? You see, the thing is, when you see kids doing stupid stuff like this, you go, well, why were they doing that? I felt a sense of power. Here I was, I had the magic stuff, the magic recipe, that would blow shit up. It was my power. I didn't have a car. I didn't have, you know, a girlfriend. I had my way. I could blow shit up if I wanted to. I could blow that kid up who's yelling at me. I'm watching you. I could blow you up. You know, and I think that's what you see a lot of. You go, you find these kids, and these kids have 6 billion bomb plans. You're like, what are you doing, you little nut? And it turns out that, I mean, that's, I think that at the core, that's what some of them do. My sight, like I said, that and, of course, drugs. Now, normally I wouldn't have even cared. I wouldn't even, you know, I mean, it's popular and I wouldn't have been bothered with it, but forces have come into play, which I'll talk about later, which actually starts to get in my way. There's so much stuff on my site that were these weird little subcultural things that came back. Let me think what of a good one. Real files, that's one of my favorites. Somebody came out with a file, are you familiar with the book Real Men Don't Eat Quiche? Yeah, you see, that's the thing, now the book is kind of fallen, it was published in like 1981, Real Men Don't Eat Quiche, and it was a very easy idea to rip off. Basically, you make this list, and you say, real men don't do this, real men don't do this, for humor. Well, obviously, this was an easy thing to rip off of. So the Real Pirates Guide came out, by Rabbit Rasta, and it said, this, you know, you real pirates use this, you know, they only pirate off these kind of systems, they don't put their name on things they didn't crack, yada yada. This led to people going to Real Pirates Guide 2, the Real Freakers Guide, the Real Anarchist Guide, some really wacky one, the Real Couriers Guide. You know, you have these ones where these people are printing out these files, and eventually there is this weird subcultural group of files that represent something that's really not there anymore in that context. That's what I'm trying to save. When I'm saving the bomb files, I'm saving that cultural need by kids to portray power by going to some library, or better yet, just grabbing the Anarchist Cookbook, copying out a few things, putting their name on it, and going, yeah! And that's, you know, that's what you get. Now, this scares parents, this scares authority figures, because they think these kids are gonna make it. And my attitude is, if you like blowing stuff up, go into pyrotechnics, because you will blow up neat stuff for money, you'll get a name for yourself, you'll be in the movies, I mean, you know, you'll lose fingers, but you'll be really, you get these people like, yeah, I'm great at this. So, let's see. When textfiles.com came out, it was, you know, a lot of people liked it, and I got a lot of thank yous, and I got a lot of people coming up from the shadows who, you know, were really happy. One moment, let me turn this off. Shut up! Anyway. We'll see if they know where I am. Anyway, so... damn it!
Answer it.
Take off the bat.
Answer it.
I'm speaking right now. Gotta talk to you later. Anyway, okay. The first major clusterfuck with textfiles.com came on late April last year when a couple kids decided we're going to blow our entire school up. Speaking, of course, of the, let's see, it's had many names. I like Columbine Tragedy, Columbine Event, the, you know, basically, you know, the happy twins going nuts. And what happened was that the satirical forces in our country were well at work, well ahead of schedule. The Trenchcoat.org domain was registered 8 hours after the tragedy.
We wouldn't know anything about that.
And a site came up basically with a very satirical look at it. Now, the nature of satire is more biting the sooner it happens. You've had cases in the past. I can think of National Lampoon, where they would actually broadcast the speeches of the president and have somebody sitting there ripping on him as he's talking. You know, it adds some flavor. But at 8 hours afterwards, people didn't like that. So I'll just recount it because you'll feel emotions well up in you when the thing says, you know, a load of bullets, $150, assault rifle, $200, black trench coat, $75, look on your classmates' faces, priceless. And so on. You see, now it's a year later and you're like, oh man, and imagine it's that day. Well, they included a few links, including the Van Heusen, who told them to stop. You know, basically the site had to say, oh, go here. Well, they linked to me. The way that I found this out was one morning I woke up and, being the nerd that I am, checked my referral logs, mostly because my hits had really grown. You know, I mean, it was like, I got a bit of a hit. Usually that means, oh, I got slash dotted or somebody pointed out to me somewhere else. Well, I'm getting all these hits from trenchcoat.org, and I'm thinking, oh, no, what has happened? So I go to trenchcoat.org, and I'm leafing through it, and I'm like, ooh. So at the bottom, it helpful links, explosives with a purpose, right into my explosives directory, with a collage of the crying kids right next to it. I'm like, I am so fucked. I am so fucked, they're gonna destroy me! So I pulled off the explosives director. I did not get rid of it. I renamed it to Incendiaries. My theory was, if you're so young you don't know what Incendiaries is, I protected you. Incendiaries? I don't want that. And I put up this, well, as you might know when you go to the site, I put up another one of my little right gets into the heart things about freedom of expression and I'm hurt by this and yada 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 and all that. Well, people would link to textfiles.com, people would go to the, they hit the directory and then they would link up, they would you know, figure out, hey, you know, let's go up to the top of this site, and they would find my email address. I was the only email address you could find. Trenchcoat.org for some reason didn't have an email address the first couple of days, I don't know why. So I got some great mail. You are sick. You are the one that should be shot. You don't fit in, and now you take it out on people that are athletic and who are of a different race. And you make light of what happens in Colorado. Everyone has problems. You make fun of this kind of thing. These problems could get bigger for you, because although people may have teased you for being a trench coat nerd, they will not tolerate you at all if they find out you are the one behind this garbage. People like you are the reason people died in Colorado. All those trench coat assholes should be shot. It isn't the jocks that are the problems. It's people like you who can't get over your fallacies and blame it on others who, like you, who don't fit in. Now, everything split, that's a typical one. That one actually has periods, which is really nice. I bet people are bugging the shit out of you right now, aren't they? I thought it was funny. Who the fuck are you? Are you a part of these bitches who are the trench coat hoes? Or are you just a Doc's mirror person? Thanks. Dude, so you're not in the Trenchcoat Mafia? I've been looking for these people ever since I heard about this, and you had to do this. I'm mad. I wanted to talk to them. I feel the same way they do. One third of the files told me to die. One third of the mail told me to die, and I'll read one or two more because they're extremely entertaining, explained to me very quickly how I should die for being in the Trenchcoat Mafia. One third said, dude, nice site. And they found textfiles.com that way. One third, and I'm not kidding this, and this is what was kind of interesting, really, was one third wanted to know when the Trenchcoat Mafia was coming to their school. You know, you forget that shit. I don't know if any of you really experienced this once, where a rumor comes through school that something really bad is going to happen at 3 o'clock. And you wake up and you're like, dude, something's going on at 3 o'clock. And like by lunch, you're like, nah, it's not going to happen at 3 o'clock. I don't know. But I'll tell you, at 2:58, teacher's talking. You're like, I don't think the teacher's going to be talking for much longer. You know, watching the clock. I remember one was that the world was going to end at 2. That was like my school. And I was 1:59, man. I was like, I don't want to die in science class. This sucks. Basically, I have to assume that the rumors went around these schools, oh, dude, the Trenchcoat Mafia is coming to us next. You know? Anyway, so that was a relatively unpleasant experience. I did actually get a few, I got one or two intelligent ones. I'll just read one very quick intelligent one. Dear Jason, I realize the openness of your website is based on many of the liberties the U.S. population takes for granted. I like how well-organized your site is, but I have to tell you, the bomb-building messages are way over the line. I've worked for defense contractors most of my working life, and the things you bring to bear for the general public should not be known. They are secrets, in a sense, unclassified secrets, but still things anyone with the savvy could find. You haven't committed a crime, but I do believe that there is a certain faction of people in the general population that will respond to your website in manners other than email. You should consider these people when you release the kind of information that you have presented for anyone's consumption. The world is a much smaller place than you might believe, and we are getting closer all the time. Either we find ways to live with each other, or what? Some of us will be killed by people who've learned what they know from people like you. Just something to think about. I actually wrote to him, and he actually said, I got him to agree to disagree. To go, I don't really dig that, but fine, whatever you gotta do. So, you know, that was, I did get some of that, but I mean, a lot of it, what was it, that glorious one-line message, why doesn't it work? I want to learn how to make bombs. Anyway, so, you know, it's funny, when you open yourself up like that, I can only imagine what it must be like for the crew at 2600 or Cult of the Dead Cal or anybody who's particularly high profile, and the most amazing email that must just sewer into their lives from all over the world. I can't imagine, I'm speaking for myself, but I can't imagine any time in history where somebody has said, hey you, I like your trade, teach me that trade, which translates to, dude, teach me to hack. You know, they must get 6 billion, dude, teach me to hack.
Speaking as the main email contact for Cult of the Dead Cow, I can say yes, and we're actually planning on compiling a list of some of the best, including the guy who wanted us to hack Space Ghost because Space Ghost was mean to him.
Kill Space Ghost.
So Benny Gooflin, if you're out there, I'm talking about you.
So, now not all of the, that was a very interesting one because it ripped things apart on ways of the bombs. Again, I don't want people to make this stuff. If somebody typed a 3 instead of a 5 8 years ago, I don't want you to lose your fingers. I don't want that. There's actually a rather interesting, once again, conspiracy theories abound, but there's actually a very interesting post on Amazon.com from William Powell, the writer of the Anarchist Cookbook. It might be him, it might not be him. He's a CIA guy, he's a cyborg, you know, you don't know. But basically the idea was, he said, I wrote it when I was 19. I was going to Berkeley. I just went down to the library, copied some munitions manuals, I copied this, I copied that. I thought I could smash the state. I grew up. I got a wife, I got a kids, I teach kids. Now that thing was a mistake. I contacted my publisher, the publisher said, bite me. They own the copyright, I didn't, it's still published today. Don't buy it, please don't buy it. That's interesting, I have no way to know if this was actually him or if it wasn't, but there you go. Now, there was another interesting problem that I didn't really entirely think through when I put textfiles.com together, which of course was copyright. Some of these files are transcriptions of copyrighted materials. I don't know which ones are and which ones aren't. Obviously, a lot of kids trying to really get some street cred, some juice, would just go out and copy something that they saw somewhere and say, put in here by the Dark Overlord, you know, and that's it. So I don't know. But I've gotten a couple copyright-related threats over the past year. There's the crank and the jerk. Who wants to hear the crank first? Okay. And who wants to hear the jerk first? Okay, well, I see. It's a crank-jerk tie. All right, fine. Well, we'll go with the crank first because I can get through him very well.
What about the people who have abstained? Maybe they want to hear a different story first.
That would be bad.
Oh, sorry.
You break my flow.
Sorry.
The crank is a, well, he wrote to, well, okay, what he did was he wrote to everybody down the line on my domain. You do a domain trace. Where is it located? Who hosts it? Write to this guy, write to this guy, write to this guy. Just keep going down. He wrote a genius of a letter, which you'll glance at it, and it almost says, you owe me $20 million. If you glance at it, but you look a little closer, and what he's saying is, I had copyrighted material that I put on the internet for download, a book I wrote, and I asked people to pay me when they downloaded it. Well, it was downloaded many, many times, and I wasn't paid. That's money I am owed. So I have withdrawn my book from the internet. And anyone with that book on the internet is a violation. Anyone who downloads it owes me money. That's money that I owe, you know. And it's, you know, quotes the Magna Carta, goes all the way down, you know. And he talks about, you know, his right. And he goes, but I see that you have done this. You have linked to my, you know, my beautiful book, and you are causing these copyright violations. You can get out of trouble, out of how much you owe me, by simply sending me $50 for the book. Apparently other people have gotten this. Black Crawling Systems got this, a bunch of other people get this. But what was funny was, I didn't have the book. He among the things he sends to everybody, registered mail to everything, was a copy of the text file that he was citing with a highlighted part. Somebody wrote, the book, by the way, is about individual freedom. But the book, it's like the supreme law, the rule of individual freedom. The file he was referring to was where somebody wrote a rant on individual freedom, and somebody posted that to Usenet, and that person said, this is a pretty good rant on individual freedom. It reminds me of this guy's book I have. And he had highlighted that. By me printing his theory, and I got into his mind, it was a stinky place, was I provided a place where somebody who knew how to make copies of his book could be contacted. You see, you could go to my site, you could reach this guy who's a pirate. So I'm fomenting piracy, so yeah. So he was the crank, he was glorious, my boss. You know, at that time I was foolish enough to host textfiles.com at work. Don't do that. I actually lose a very large amount of money on text. Well, $300 a month isn't a large amount of money, but I lose $300 a month on text files. I don't sell things or text files. I don't sell CD-ROMs or T-shirts or stuff because I feel like that makes me a target. Because one thing if someone goes, you, whatever, and if I go, you know, I'm losing money on it, as opposed to, I only made $3,000 in T-shirts last week. I'm barely breaking even. You know, then maybe they'll have something to go after me. That's why there's no text file CD-ROM or T-shirts.
We'll make T-shirts for you.
Oh, we would. Excellent.
No problem.
So one day I'm at work, and somebody called one of my old work, because I still had the domain hosted there, says, some dude called about the Secret Service. That was the message. Oh yeah. I start going and checking. I call him up. I go, what the hell are you talking about? Dude, Secret Service guy number thing. Okay. I mean, because she wasn't really equipped to take that kind of a call. And I call, and he had left the message on by my voicemail that I keep with their 617 Cowtown. You know, huge rant. The Secret Service, da 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 da. So I called him. Okay, this is when I first met the gentleman who I cannot name except to say that his name is Bruce Goldberg. Bruce and I had a wonderful, wonderful conversation. Here was Bruce had an article that he had written. He had written a number of articles for USA Today, Time, Newsweek. In 1990, he had written an article, and I had the article up. Somebody transcribed the article, and they put it in. I put it in my news section, and it was his. He and I talk, okay? And this is where it was very interesting. I don't want to rile too many people who might fall along with this guy. I'm just saying, so if you agree with what he said to me, fine, okay. He was very nasty about it. That's all I'm saying. Basically, we talked for about 2 hours. That was very interesting in itself. He didn't like my site up all that much. He said, "You have stolen my property. This writing is how I make my money. You have stolen it from me and distributed it to people. I think you owe me money for stealing my property." In this country, the copyright law states that for every copyright violation, you can be fined up to $20,000 or go to prison. Would you want them to go to prison? I could have the Secret Service come and seize your computers if you can't pay me this $20,000 per file downloaded. This is where the Secret Service came in. He loved that Secret Service. That Secret Service, man, they were in his garage, soaping up the weapons, putting on the stuff, going, "Bruce, Bruce, Bruce, Bruce," waiting for his word to go in and kick my ass. Now, what's funny, of course, was that the domain was hosted in a different place where the computer was by this point, so he would have been like, But he did this, not only to me, he did this to one of my mirrors, too. He actually called up and went, "Secret Service, Secret Service." And the conversation, I can actually summarize 1 hour of the conversation. "You stole my property. I understand you think that, sir. I think you should get it back." "How would you define getting it back, sir?" "You should find everyone who downloaded it and make them delete it." "Sir, I can't do that." "You must." "But I can't." "But I want my property back." "Sir, I'll delete it off my drive." "That's not good enough." Hour. You don't want to hang up on the guy, but I mean, I'm in hell. I'm just sitting there, dude, and eventually I said, "I think we have to get the lawyers involved. Because we have this is what lawyers are for, right? Or at least independent arbiters." He says I stole something, I say I don't. Dudes come in, argue, and eventually everyone loses. He loses a lot of money, I lose a lot of money, lawyers get rich. Ironically, the article was about bringing people together online. Bulletin board systems. Anyway, so as soon as I mentioned lawyers, he went, lawyers suck. So he wrote to me one last little kick in the ass before he disappeared into the ether. And I think it's worth mentioning his words. "Jason, I wanted to tell you that I don't plan on doing anything about your theft and unauthorized distribution of my copyrighted work, so long as it ceases. I'm not going to call the cops or anything, not going to take any sort of action. What you're doing is wrong, wrong, wrong. But you already know that. You're pirating copyrighted property, which is just as serious as pirating software. And you know where that leads. Your computer systems can be seized. Statutory damages of $20,000 per violation, even prison. I tell you this because you seem like a bright guy, even though my wife thinks you're strange. I talked to her first before he came on the phone. You've done an impressive job archiving early computing documentation and lore. A lot of the material was obviously created in the spirit of collectivism." Oh, I didn't mention that. One of Bruce's really big ideas was, if you want to put a document up on your site, you should contact the original author and get written permission from him to redistribute their file. How am I going to do that with how to fuck up your parents' dinner party by the ninja? "Sir, I read your dinner party anarchy file. I was very impressed. I think that it should really reach a wider audience. I'm with textfiles.com, and if you sign this release here, we can proceed with, I think, the next phase in your fame." Anyway.
Mr. Ninja.
I saw an awful lot of articles that had clearly been reprinted from magazines and newspapers. I'll tell you this, sooner or later, you're going to get your nuts in a vice. It isn't a matter of whether, but when. You don't need to worry about me. You need to worry about Gannett and Times Mirror and other media corporations with lots of money and attorneys that have people like you and me for breakfast. What do you think a Disney lawyer Pitbull is going to do once he has his teeth in you? I saw several stories in your archive from Newsweek and Washington Post, both owned by the same company. You could have dozens of articles from that one corporation, if not hundreds. That makes you a significant target. You seem like a reasonably smart person in his late 20s with some interesting career prospects. Whatever your career plans, a stint in a federal prison will screw you up. You're making a stupid mistake that can have very serious consequences for the rest of your life. End of lecture. Leave my stuff alone and I'll leave you alone. He then proceeds to talk about his life. I was in BBSes, blah, 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 blah. I only mention that because he says, I did this, I wrote this thing. He wrote a column about computing called Body Language Using the Pen Name of Quasimodo. I've been using that name for 15 years, and although others are now using it, I was the first, near as I know. All that stuff is on disk 2. Too bad you'll never get your hands on any of it. Talk about it. His threat is that I'll never hear from him again. Thank you, Mr. Goldberg. Give me my property. Anyway, one other interesting aspect of the internet that has come out is, actually what inspired me originally for text files was I did search for an old bulletin board system I loved called Sherrod Forest 2.
Yay!
Which, Sherrod Forest 2 was in New York. It was up in near Nyack. It was a nice board. I liked it very much. It was the home of BIOC Agent 003,
yay,
which a lot of other people, well, maybe they know, maybe they don't know. BIOC Agent was one of the best writers. I'm still searching for him. I can't find the guy, but well, you do your best. Anyway, so I did a search on the web figuring, I'll find the Sherrod Forest 2, users of Sherrod Forest 2 support page. Let's all get together and talk about how great times were. Nothing. Not a thing, not a mention of it, not a mention of the boards around it, and I was like, it's gone, it's not there, it's not online. That scared me. That scared me because it means very much to me. This is my niche. This is where I live. I live in this, I have a part of me that has this hobby of keeping track of the past and trying to remember all the important things that happened back then, because a lot of things that we're dealing with right now, up to the minute, are things that were evident there. I mean, there were flame wars. There were people destroying other people's stuff. There were people indicating that these bulletin board systems are going to change everything. Law enforcement. I have a beautiful file from a law enforcement agency. The danger of BBSs. You know, beautiful article where he's just, these things are cauldrons of evil. Wonderful. Single line, Commodore 64. Oh no. Anyway, actually, one of my greatest, the shameful confessions are coming out this time. There were a couple boards I had to get on, and I loved them. I got on them, and I did my posting, but then it would be busy for days and days and days, and 3 o'clock in the morning would come, and it'd still be busy, and I couldn't. Anyway, so sometimes I would call up the operator. And I need to reach my friend really badly. There's something wrong. I need to reach my friend. And she go, okay, sir. I need an emergency breakthrough. I need to get through, sir. I need to get through. And she go, okay, sir. Let me try. Sir, there seems to be something wrong with the line. Oh, really? Well, I'll try again later. Click. I'm in. Oh, baby. To all those people I knocked off, I'm so sorry. I had to read the 9 new messages in the freaking board. So, those little memories. You don't really encounter busy signals as much anymore. Once you're on, you don't really encounter. Well, actually, I guess you get the 404s and the
you're trying to call your friend who's only has one phone line.
Yeah, use emergency breakthrough on your buddy. In fact, let me think. Wait, somebody. Oh, that's right. Mogel, who was a co-contributor. Mogel, a co-contributor to my site, told me this site. We were having this deep confession one day in the Suite of the Elite. He told me that he knew that his, I hope this was mogel. This actually might have been.
It doesn't matter.
Yeah, it doesn't matter, I guess. But I don't want to. I don't want to ascribe this to the wrong person. He had a program set up where if he could not get onto his bulletin board system, it would one by one call all of his friends in conjunction, so their call waiting would kick in, and then he would be able to get back on. Because he knew it had to be one of them. You know, try? No. Call John? No. Call John? That's shameful. But it's very, very, very creative. So, you know, I guess that's part of the fun. Since I come out with this site, I wanted this site to be the kind of dream site I've always wanted, where when I was searching for Share at Force 2, I'd stumble along textfiles.com and go, holy shit, and just want to download it. And it's very funny, because I see people who do this. I see people who feel like I do. They come onto my site, boom, wget, I mean, they just rip it. They just go in, and they're just, boom, all night.
I think the proper term is leech.
Huh?
Leech?
Yes, they leech. Yes, they leech. They leech worldwide. So to fix that, I started, like I said, compressing archives. I made the mistake, or make a mistake, I have made the decision where I put up a link to a archive of the entire site in one archive. Luckily, my ISP is dumb. I remember saying, talking to these guys, and they were like, oh, what is your site about, your popular site? Because I warned them, I'm going to have a popular site, you might get some phone calls, just directing me. And they're like, what's it about? And I go, BBSs. And they go, what's that? This is an ISP. So, putting a 207 meg tar GZ file and going, this is the whole site. Suddenly my usage went from, I think it's on me, I'm currently using 700 or 800 megabytes a day of text. Downloading, it shot up to 4 gigs a day. And it's still there. Right now, as we speak, I mean, this poor thing is just, it's a 486. And it's just, boom, boom. The day I was slashdotted, a glorious day, and I'll always remember it, I remember going over to the computer and the light, disk drive light was on. And it was on. And I remember I was like doing some stuff and I kept glancing, on. The disk drive light stayed on for 8 straight hours. Never blinked once, just the whole time. I mean, this was a 486 I'd gotten out of the trash. And it was just pumping up. So that did tell me that I had tapped into something that people were interested in. So that was a good sign right there. So I did actually keep up with it. Now, like I said, I wanted this dream thing of like, oh, and here they all are. Here's all the text files. And I'm trying to actually increase it by saying, here's articles written by the original people about their text files and really giving some real perspective to it. Well, there are an entire other range of kids in the world who are part of the same breed that used to go on to sites and claim they had credit card numbers they didn't. We'll go on and talk about their bulletin board system and try to charge for access. Who, like little snake oil salesmen, will grab 40 or 50 of my files, or have 40 or 50 files, I won't claim they got them from me, and put them up on their site. Porn banner, porn banner, porn banner, 3 files, porn banner, porn banner, porn banner, where's 3 links, MP3, 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 hacker ROMs here, links. And it's like, you can't blame the kid for being industrious, you know. But I'm just thinking, what disservice you're doing, you know. I mean, I'm sitting here giving this shit out for free because I want people to have it, and you got to make your little 5 cents per click because you want somebody to have an old file. No context, just cool bomb files. And they're actually, I guess that's more me going tut tut, you know. I'm my little store, and I'm laughing at the little store down the street that sells them for. It's the deep linkers I have learned to hate. The deep linkers are the people who have my entire site up on their site, and each link actually links to my site, and yanks them off. Text as wares. Text says something that somebody says, I'm going to rip them. They can't even spare the bandwidth for text. 3K text files, and they're going to rip them off from me. They're going to burn. They're going to burn. A couple of the sites, you know, like I said, I do the refers because it's always kind of interesting. The ones that scare me are the ones, well, there was one kid, he had a site up that was just anti-police, police suck, the police, I'm like, The police suck, the police suck. Go here to find recipes to blow up the police. The four words a librarian does not want to hear is blow up the police and pointing to you. So
I wouldn't know anything about that.
No, you wouldn't know a damn thing about that. I used to run a bulletin board system called the Works BBS. This was in 1986 that I started it. Oh my God, you've heard of it. Oh, I see what you did, okay. I started a bulletin board system in 1986 based on a PC port that I'd written of a BBS program called Waffle, which was originally on a board called the Dark Side of the Moon.
Yay!
408-245 spam. And
which should be up anytime again soon. Where is he?
Resurrect that baby.
Where is he?
So anyway.
I know where you live!
The sysop, I'm glorious sysop. So it was originally a port of Waffle, and then it went to other software. I ran it for about 2 or 3 years. My father and I had a little bit of a falling out that ended in that line being shut off, and me moving to Boston. I thought that line was free. Dad had a IBM purchase line. I loved it. More confession on tape. My father had what do they call it? The Guardian system. It was a callback system. You dialed into their computer, and their computer would hang up on you, and it would call back the number attached to your user account and then validate you. So IBM provided my father with a phone line for free. Well, the bills didn't come to my father. The phone line was in the name of IBM Corporation, Armonk, New York. So I started with a few couple long-distance calls because I couldn't remember a code for that day. I made a couple calls 1 month. Nothing happened. Made a few more calls. 6 months later, Alliance Teleconference! Calling everywhere! Fuck that code, it's like an IBM behind me! IBM eventually tallied it and pulled my father into a thing and said, "Sir, why did you make $11,000 worth of calls? You were calling the local dial-up." Dad came home. That was that for that phone line. So the bulletin board system went down. About a year or two later, I got into conversation with a young gentleman who sounded very young, who I knew through another bulletin board system named Dave. And I had software that I'd written called Ferret BBS, and he took it. People started calling him after that. He became Dave Ferret. And he put up the Works, and that's the Works that most people know. I think it was a CDC board for a while. It was a bunch of other things. It was, my original board was where a very young person named Skeeve would come on. And the other board Skeeve became a co-sysop, and he grew up to be a very nice little boy. They all come from somewhere, I tell you.
Yikes.
He changed his name to a much more loving name, I guess. Anyway, so for me, there was a part of this that that was my little part, my little stake in all this. And so I collected text files. I was a text file BBS. So that's where the original collection came when I built the current one. Now, I'm going to shift gears just for the last part of my talk here. Unfortunately, or fortunately, depending on if you're a junkie or not, the major shift in computer usage has unfortunately almost primarily become the need to understand politics to some degree. I was never a big fan of watching laws being made and watching the whole process. It's the whole sausages analogy. You might want to eat them, but you don't want to know how they're being made. And as a result, I've had to keep my eye on laws that are coming out. Every few years now, there are proposed laws that are going through the House that just make me shit my pants. They have great names, too. I mean, they have those names that you can't stand up against these names. The one I'm specifically thinking of is, the Anti-Terrorism Defense Act. I mean, what are you going to stand up and go, "That sounds really fine. You don't need to be going after terrorism." Well, the person who's behind this is a nice lady, called Dianne Feinstein. She was the mayor of San Francisco for a while. I heard a rumor, this is just a rumor, she passed a bunch of, I'll explain about her whole gun position too, but apparently she was busted for bringing a gun on an airplane. Her or one of her people had like a gun, walked through an airplane. Anyway, I heard that, and I haven't found the, I was going crazy trying to find that article just before now, but I will spread that horrible rumor about her. She's had a number of interesting laws. Obviously, she has passed some important legislation, like the White Zinfandel Grape Week Act of 2000, which declares January 21st through 28th of 2001 to be National Grape, White Grape Zinfandel Week, in recognition of all the things that... Thank God. Children rest easy in their beds. She has things that she believes very strongly in. She doesn't want to see babies explode. We're really at the other side on this issue. She doesn't want to see babies explode, so how do we prevent the babies from exploding? Well, let's make it so that nothing in the world can explode. How do we make it so nothing can... Don't talk about the exploding. The first rule of explosions is don't talk about explosions. Second rule of explosions, don't talk about explosions. So she started to go after... she put up this thing where she said, you can't discuss bomb-making on the internet. And people in Congress said, what the fuck are you talking about? Of course they can talk about that. So she had to morph it a little bit. So again, you can't discuss this stuff with the intent to harm. So now it's, that kind of passed. People said, well, okay, that's fine. So that one actually got through and got killed in committee. She did this again. She keeps trying to do it, her and Orrin Hatch. Sometimes you'll see Orrin Hatch's name attached to it. Sometimes it's her name. But it really has her stink about it. She had a law where she didn't want guns in churches. I love that one. She's also constantly trying to have everything reclassified as an assault weapon. Because they finally had something, you know, you can't have assault weapons. She's trying to have everything. If something could potentially be used for an assault weapon, she wants it banned.
Steak knife.
And so she doesn't, you know, that's her approach. Now, fine. I've always been afraid of that, that eventually, the most important thing about all of her laws, the real chrome, nitrous-burning part of the engine of her law, is that they always have these unbelievable, bowel-loosening sentences attached to them. Because it's one thing to go, oh, that damn law, you know, they say I can't drive with my shoes off, I'm going to drive with my shoes off. I might get, you know, a ticket. But one of them, put up bomb-making information with intent to distribute, 20 years. $10,000 fine, something like that. An enormous amount of time. Well, now, what position does that put me in that I've got, you know, anarchy for fun and profit? And the person, I could argue, but now I'm not talking about, oh, I got in trouble. Oh, I'm talking 20 years for that. You know, the idea here is the initial solution is, boom, you know, go into surfing. Just turn off that computer and get the hell out of the house, which I don't obviously want to do. So I've been kind of running the site. But it's important to me that the files get out. I don't want people to use them. I just want people to have them. I want text files to become wares again. I want them to become this thing, this block, that people trade and keep. And things people said, some very funny, wonderful things, some horrible things, some nasty things, all this wonderful human discourse, I want it saved, preserved, referenced, contexted. I have kids who are... I'm thinking, of course, of Mr. Ohm, who was this kid. He was 15 at Hope. And I, you know, came in there and I was introducing myself to Cheshire, because I was like that guy. And they go, oh, he's the text files comm guy. Mr. Ohm, who's 15, turns to me and goes, whoa, I learned all my freaking from you. That makes me proud. I said, don't build the blue box. Don't do it. The blotto box!
Or perhaps the urine box?
We already mentioned the blotto box last year. The blotto box was a box that would destroy an area code.
The urine box was the one that would kill the person at the other end.
The urine box would kill everyone at the other end of the line. And the blotto box would blow everyone up, but it was the only box that involved a Honda generator. One of my favorite lines was, when the blue sphere of electricity shoots from the exchange, run like hell. I smashed the state. Nobody can dial Hoboken. Now, I thought that, you know, I'd always like worried about the bomb info, and I knew I was always like risking something being there. But then, I did not expect, or maybe I should have, that the focus would kind of move away from bombs, because nobody's killed anybody in the news and major massacre in the country for enough thing that the country's kind of yawned and moved on. But drugs, I didn't expect this whole anti-methamphetamine thing. There was an act that Diane's been trying to get through for some time. The Methamphetamine Anti-Proliferation Act of 1999, at least it's named what it is. Let's stop methamphetamines from getting everywhere. And once again, she moves into her little thing of like, let's get people to stop talking about them. Let's get people to stop talking. And she actually, it doesn't really say methamphetamines, it says illegal drugs. And it says you can't have, now once again, this has changed in the last week, but the original intent of the law was you can't have information on how, you can't have information on the use, you cannot discuss the use, you cannot link to a site that does any of these things. In all those cases, 20 years! Could you imagine? 20 years for linking to High Times. You in the bar is going, oh man. Well, that's the thing. Now, they've changed this, that, the other thing. In the past week, they've gotten rid of, like, the linking part, and it was adhered to a bankruptcy act. So it's bankruptcy act, drug proliferation anti-act. Empowerment of Women Act, actually, is on there, too. And then more bankruptcy. So it's this heinous griffon that the Congress has created. So I don't know if it'll go through it, if it'll not go through it, if it'll be killed or whatever in committee or whatever. But this is that day-to-day weird ass, let's go after this big crazy internet thing, just drives me up the wall. So that's part of why I made the entire site downloadable. But I really don't think that's enough protection. I expect that maybe someday I might be shut down. Somebody might come up with some really cool excuse and the political thing of the day, and somebody everyone loves will die of methamphetamines, and they'll go, we have to get rid of these, and they'll go for me. I did one little piece of political, angry, whatever. You know that wonderful art, and I'm going, it starts with S-T-E, and I always pronounce it wrong, where you put messages into pictures. Yeah, I took one of my methamphetamine recipes and put it in Diane Feinstein's picture and put it up on my site. Yeah. Now, I do not say the recipe works. The passphrase is First Amendment, and it's an idea encrypted and yada yada. It was like 10 minutes, download the tools, do it. Oh, yay, I'm an activist. So I did that, but I don't think, you know, man, that's not really where I want to be. I am concerned that someday it's going to be me in the little friggin' suit with, like, some ACLU lawyer, EFF lawyer, random suit over here saying, I should be killed. I should go away for the rest of my life for how to fuck up your parents' dinner party. Let me think of another grand classic. What's a really...
How to Kill Santa Claus Dead?
How to Kill Santa Claus Dead. With its sequel, How to Kill the Easter Bunny Dead.
Thank you, Neon Knights.
Yeah, the Neon Knights. The Neon Knights and Metal Communications. So, another fine group that has disappeared.
Bunny Lust.
Sex with Satan was one of my favorites. I want to be in...
That's the file Rivera called CDC a bunch of sickos for.
Yeah, that's right. I want that in front of me at a congressional hearing. Just anyway, so unfortunately, you know, realism rears its ugly head. I am always touched by the stories of the guys who go, I fought up against the government, my life was destroyed, I lost everything I own, I fought the government, you should fight the government too. And I'm like, dude. Oh. you know, I don't want to be that guy. I don't want to be that guy. I'm just an archivist. So my next solution was, well, I'm in the middle of work, of working on this project. Why don't I make copies and give them to people? Why don't I turn textfiles.com into a where? You can't give away 5K files anymore. It's too small. In a world where people are downloading 4 megabyte files to listen to Mariah Carey, could you imagine? Rip some 13-year-old out of 83, bring him here and go, yeah, we've stumbled over 4 meg files. Dude, 4 megabytes! Holy shit, what is it? What did you put it on?
What?
Who?
What did you put it on?
4 megabytes.
4 megabytes? 460 C64s strapped together with duct tape. Yeah, baby. Dude, Defense Department of Defense computer. You know, it's just this incredible, you know, nobody pays attention to the little text file, so you gotta make it big. You know, when people like, you know, they download the 400 megabyte ASF of Fight Club. You know, you want to get their attention. You go, here's a where. Something you can throw a CD-ROM with. So I did. Now, once again, I said I'm not selling textfiles.com CD-ROMs. I'm giving them away.
In very sharp.
What I'd like to do is... Thank you. What I'd like to do is, I was doing this before, but nobody was listening. Now they listen. I was trying to find a CD-ROM burner. Give it to the guy and go, you go for it. Do it on a waste box so there's no virus put on it. They're text files. But you never know, right? You know, in a world where there's auto-run. Anyway, the idea here is, I want people, right now what this CD contains, and again, this is part actually of why I love that I was born when I was born, because from a time when one of these things, let's just use the Apple example, 160K per side, and to get the second side, you had to make a notch in the single, there were single-sided and there were double-sided floppies. Double-sided floppies were fuck expensive compared to the single, double price. You know, verification and all that, but people figured out very quickly that all the single-sided meant was, it wasn't the greatest second side. So, what they would do is, they would make a notch here, you could flip it over, and you could use the second side as if it was the first side. Double. Was that 420K on one of these floppies? When we switched over.
360.
360?
360.
Really?
Yes.
Okay.
There's 180 on one side.
I bow to your knowledge of the old times. The ancient knowledge. So anyway, so when you compare that to 640 megabytes plus, yes, cheap ass tricks to get more, but, you know, I mean, this is incredible to me. I still am at wonder, you know, just, I love this. I love that people were able to put all this crap on little plastic pieces of shit. I knew that, I don't like the phrase, I'm starting to feel old. I felt a little weird in a computer store when I saw, you know, the new Rayman Adventures, free magnet inside. It was a computer game with a free magnet inside of the main character. Holy shit! They fixed that little magnet problem. So, you know, this to me, I just love this. I love that. I love the business card sized ones that can fit the 200 meg. Boom, baby! My life! Right there, on the card. Flip it over. So, what's on here is the current textfiles.com site. The thing identifies itself as the DEFCON remix, because it's really cool to give some lame-ass little file you typed up 2 seconds before you burnt it with bad spelling to say, look, it's my stuff. It's all of textfiles.com as it currently stands, all of scene.textfiles.com, which is a site run by Mogel, which is where, after a while, I got really tired of people mailing me and going, dude, new version of my zine is now out. It was just driving me nuts, so he took that over. So the new, it's like a collection as of 3 days ago of all the newest links to all the newest e-zines, and my inbox, which would make a hardened marine cry. It's 600 megabytes of stuff. By by the way, if you donate me text files, and I should actually make a call for that, I love getting donated text files. Don't sort them for me before they come in. Except for, if you can, delete all the fracks. Because people send me, like, I send you 80 megs of text files, and, you know, it's almost all frack. I got frack. I got all the fracks. I went to frack.com and got all the fracks. This is not lost knowledge. I got them. So other than that, you know, don't sort through them because it takes more time. Just give me all the stuff. I got all these tools. Boom, boom, boom. Go through all of them. It's really great. But as a result, the inbox is massive. So it's the entire inbox. If I were to just stop doing text files today, which I am not, you could take this file, unpack it in your directory, and you have the site. You could theoretically continue my work. It's really boring. But you could. But it's out there. It's turned into a where. It's a 566 meg tar GZ. Throw it up on a file sharing thing. Throw it up on some decentralized thing. Dude, I got 420 Genesis ROMs. I got Fight Club. I have every major text file ever made in the 19... There's those great commercials with that one place where they go, what kind of, how's your room service? We don't have room service. How's this? We don't have that. Do you have towels? No. Do you have any movies? We have every movie in every language ever made. That would be my dream, where just someone goes, hey man, what's that file over there? That little 700 meg file, I could download that right now. Oh, that's every text file made by every bulletin board system ever. That's what I'm shooting for. I'm shooting for that. So I want people to take this. I don't care what you do with it. It's not really that important to me that you complete my incredible work, you know, the half-finished, you know, portrait of Al Bell that I, you know, I'm constructing out of a mountain. I don't need, you know, you don't have to do that. All I want is you take it, you shove it in a drawer, you shove it somewhere, you put it on a hard drive, you stick it in the MP3 directory, you don't care. It's there, it's saved, it's preserved forever. And that's what I'm all about.